We all agree now, we are whole is going through a crisis of COVID. And when it comes to India, whether to take vaccine or not is an issue which many people are discussing. It's a classic case where risk communication can be done in a better way. I think this is where we need to address all these things. You all agree that we want science and technology to find solutions to the problems faced by the people. And while doing so, if you do not communicate to the people appropriately, then you end up in the problems like what we're facing, the dilemma of whether to take COVID vaccine or not. So, as a part of the research that's going on at NIAS, we have commissioned this Let Us Discuss RISCOM series. This is fourth in the series. We had a very good beginning with Professor V.S. Ramamurthy starting the meeting, the series. It was followed by Dr. Srivastava, who talked about the health pandemics and how did we face, how did the world face, and how did it handle it. And the last episode was with Dr. Parthasarathy, who talked about how to communicate to risk. And today we have Dr. Malhotra. I think I will briefly introduce Dr. Malhotra to the audience. And Dr. Malhotra had a very distinguished career with the Department of Atomic Energy, and he superannuated as an outstanding scientist in 2015. And subsequently, he's been awarded Rajaramanna Fellowship. He was also appointed as Secretary of Atomic Energy Educational Society of the department, the post which he held with distinction. I think the important aspect of Dr. Malhotra is that since almost 1999, he was heading the public awareness activities of the department. He was responsible for outreach programs of the department and also was a spokesperson of the department. So he was involved with the IAEA for assessing and advising them on their public information program. And Dr. Malhotra has been bestowed with several awards, mainly because of due to his contribution to science communication. And he's a fellow of the Indian Science Writers Association and Mahakoshal Vigyan Parishad, and is also the immediate past president of the Indian Society of Analytical Chemists. Currently, he's the secretary of Indian Nuclear Society and also in the managing committee of the National Association for Application of Radioisotopes and Radiation in Industry. More than all that, he's been a good friend of mine, personal friend, and he has been the voice of the department to and to the people. So we are happy to have Dr. Malhotra being part of the Let's Discuss RISCOM series. And we welcome again Dr. Malhotra and address us. Dr. Malhotra, the whole episode is you can address us for about half an hour or so, 30, 35 minutes, then followed by two of the scholars, Nandagopan and Siddharth Sinha, whom I'm calling as discussants of the meeting, would ask you a few questions, two questions each. Then it will be open to the people for their others for interacting with you. So thank you and welcome to Let Us Discuss RISCOM series. Yeah. Now the platform is to you, Dr. Malhotra.
Yeah, thank you very much. I thank NIAS. I thank Professor Sai Baba and his team, his colleagues, his students for inviting me. And it is a real honor to be part of the series where stalwarts like, I mean, it was, as already told by Professor Sai Baba, that it was started by Professor V.S. Ramamurthy, whom, in fact, I personally keep him in a very high place. And then, of course, the other speakers also have been the stalwarts, like Dinesh Srivastava. Again, I admire him a lot and personally my very good friend. I mean, senior friend, I should say. And then Dr. Parthasarathy, he himself is a doyen of science communication. I admire him also a lot. So feel really honored that after these three stalwarts, I am the next speaker. So friends, today I think I will speak about, as you can see in the title, risk communication in nuclear energy. I'll talk about it. What aspects I'll talk, why should we communicate, when should we communicate, to whom should we communicate, what should we communicate, and how should we communicate. I think all these, I will try to give answers. They are not based on any expertise I have gained, because I do not claim I am an expert of science communication. I often say that I was working peacefully in Bhabha Atomic Research Center. I was doing my own R&D, and the type of work I was doing there was not much public exposure to me. So, you know, other than attending a few conferences here and there, I had never attended any public program of Department of Atomic Energy. And one fine day, I am ordered from the topmost person of the Department of Atomic Energy, that is Dr. Chidambaram at that time, that from tomorrow onwards, you are supposed to take care of this public awareness division. And so, in fact, I often tell people that without asking me whether I know swimming or not, I was thrown into the sea. And actually, I did not know swimming. And even today, I do not know swimming, but I know how to survive in the sea. So that is what I am doing. So I will only share that experience, that how to survive while communicating in the field of science and technology, and particularly risk communication. So we can have the next slide, please. So friends, I will start with, you know, I'll just give a comparison. I'll talk about the assessed risk versus perceived risk. See, if they were the same, probably there would not have been too much need for science communication, as I said. So as you know, assessed risk is a scientific exercise where you one determines possible mishaps, their likelihood and consequences, and the tolerances for such events. It's a perfectly scientific exercise: probabilistic safety analysis, failure analysis, reliable engineering. So many aspects are taken into consideration while assessing the risk of any machinery or any system. It could be related to human health, human life, buildings, infrastructure, environment, etc. So, and it could be because of a single operation or because of a series of operations. Now, when we come to risk perception, is you calculated the risk. Now, you know the risk, you have calculated, and you are very confident that the risk is going to be this much, plus minus, you know, whatever is the basis of your calculation. But how does the public perceive the risk? So that becomes important, because that becomes the rate determining step. Actually, that, see, you assess the risk, you know what is the risk, but what does the public think of? So public may be underestimating that risk, or they may be overestimating the risk. So I think, as you can see, I have explained here that you have a scientifically, at the bottom of the slide, you can see the red central line. It denotes the scientifically assessed risk. But the actual perceived risk could be very high. It could be an amplified risk because of receiving increased public attention. Or it could be an attenuated risk receiving decreased public attention. Just to give you an example, about nuclear energy plant, I will say it is very safe. There is no worry to, nothing to worry about radioactive waste. But then the public will perceive this risk as very high. No. How can you say that everything is safe? So many accidents have happened. So there will be always the perceived risk is an amplified risk in case of atomic energy. I think one example which I will give you, the only one example I have seen, that and that too with an individual who had a attenuated risk with respect to atomic energy or a part of the atomic energy. And while we see the behavior, I have been watching the TV, you also must be seeing, that on the television they are showing reports. Of course, those reports are also confusing. They are showing, particularly now they are talking about Bombay, that the COVID cases are increasing. And the last 3 days I am seeing that they show the Dadar vegetable market, the crowd there, and they show people without masks. They show that people are not following that 2 yard distance, Do Gaj Ki Duri, the typical popular slogan. That also is not being followed. And they are telling that how irresponsible the people are. So people are being criticized. And this is a typical case of an attenuated risk. Probably those people, they do not know what is the risk they are subjecting to. They are thinking, kuch nahi hoga. But actually they are subjecting themselves to risk. But why did I say these reports are confusing? You know, when they are talking about COVID, they will show the Bombay vegetable market, but the next moment they will be talking about the election in West Bengal and the rally in Kharagpur of a given leader. I'll avoid using names of leaders. So a given presently ruling party leader, and that time they will show a crowd whose magnitude is much higher than the Dadar vegetable market. I mean, people are the mean free path is much lesser. People are really very close to each other. And they are also not wearing the mask. But there the people are not being criticized. They are being complimented. They are. It is being claimed that these are all the people who are going to vote in the election. And today's this election rally is highly successful. That is why I say I get confused. Whether the COVID virus is there only in the other vegetable market? Is it not there in West Bengal? Is it not there where the political rallies are taking place? These are some questions. I think our conscience has to reply them. Anyway, I move ahead. Next slide, please. So now here, in fact, before explaining this, I will tell you, see, my style is I give a lot of examples, a lot of stories in my talks. My way of communicating is, you give certain scientific facts, but so that they become deep rooted in the minds of the public, you must give some correlating stories or some examples. So here I will give you an example from Indian film industry, the Hindi film industry. There was a film of Amitabh Bachchan when he was not a star in his initial struggling days. There was a film and the name of the film was Sanjog. Sanjog means by chance. You know, so in that movie, I think he had a girlfriend, ex-girlfriend, but he could not marry her. And he married another lady and he had a child with that. And ultimately, they again, in their life, they come across each other. So now it becomes a known fact that Mr. Amitabh Bachchan knows this particular lady besides his wife. So one day they cross each other on the street and only for a moment they look at each other, but then others are watching. So one lady goes and tells another lady that today she does a real reporting that what did she see. Now this lady who received the signal from first lady, she goes and tells the second lady, she magnifies the signal a little bit. So she doesn't say they just looked at each other. They even smiled at each other. And then the third lady comes to know that they even winked at each other. Fourth lady comes to know they even shook hand with each other. Fifth lady probably that they hugged each other. Sixth lady probably they kissed each other. And so finally when the story reaches his wife, I think they had already done everything. But in the perceived story only. So same thing applies to this perceived risk. Now here, this slide I have written. The title is Amplification of Perceived Risk, the Ripple Effect. So this is the ripple effect. One small stone you throw into the pond and it creates a ripple. Okay. So similar is the situation. So behavior of individuals and groups then generates secondary social or economic impacts, you know, which also increase or decrease the physical risk itself. Not only they increase or decrease the perceived risk, they actually changed the assessed risk also. And then these secondary changes, then they produce tertiary changes, and like that the ripples go on. And ultimately, you know, it could result in something totally different. What was anticipated by the original risk, something else is the result. So result could be enduring mental perceptions. So people get tensed up. There are a lot of, you know, people get charged up because of these increased risks. There are impacts on business sales. There are, you know, Bharat burns and the market closed, these kind of things. There is change in the residential property values. So this is very important. This I have faced. I will tell a small story here. And then it changes in the training and the education. Education system also gets disrupted. And there can be a total social disorder. So these are all the ripple effects of the gap between the assessed risk and the perceived risk. So if you need to dampen the gap, you need to reduce the gap where the importance of risk communication comes. Now, before I really switch over to risk communication, I'll tell you a little thing about this residential property value. I remember one incident that way back in 2001, people who are of my age, they will know. I think some of the young students, they will not know this incident. Somewhere in late 90s, there was a site in Punjab which was considered for nuclear power station. It was just one of the possible sites. So some site selection exercises were done. It's a scientific exercise that was done, and people came to know that one site in Punjab is being considered for nuclear power station. And as it happens, nothing, not even a brick had been laid there. In fact, the decision whether there will be a power station there or not had not been taken. But there were groups, you know, anti-nuclear lobby was formed there, and they were talking about, we will not allow any nuclear power station here. It came to their legislative assembly also. And every time question will be asked, even in Indian parliament, Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, questions were asked. And they were told that, no, but in Punjab, we should not allow nuclear power station to come. And so all this was being discussed. And ultimately, I think it really became too much. And my that time chairman, Dr. Anil Kakodkar, in 2002, he gave me marching orders. He told, Malhotra, I don't know what you do, but you go to Punjab and you plug all this, whatever is happening. And I give you freedom. You go and declare that we are not thinking of any nuclear power station in Punjab. So anyway, I thought I will not go directly and announce it. So I arranged one public awareness program there, a 2-day seminar. So people thought that now I am coming there to convince them that why we need a nuclear power station there. So when we were inaugurating the event, there were a lot of people with black flags. There was some genuine audience, but there were people with black flags, and they were shouting, Malhotra, go back. DAE, go back. I had gone there with some of the colleagues from NPC, ILB, ARC, and DAE. We were a full team. Anyway, with great difficulty, we did the inauguration. And my colleagues, they advised me that during the inauguration, you declare. I mean, they knew that I'm going to make a declaration. So I said, no, I'm not going to declare now. Let the opposition reach to speak. So anyway, up to lunchtime, I held the information. And that black flag and shouting of the slogans was going on. Finally, after the lunch when we met, somewhere at 3 or 3:30, there was my slot. As a speaker, I got up and I had to deliver my speech. I delivered my technical lecture. I delivered the lecture, completed it. And then I said that most of you must be wondering that I have come along with my team to convince you people and to plead with you that please allow us to set up the power station here. But now the time has come that I inform you that I am, as a spokesperson of DAE, I am declaring, I am making an announcement. And then I told them that I will be retiring in 2015, so another 13 years. So I give you guarantee up to that time that up to 2015, at least there will be no nuclear power station in Punjab. After that, what happens, I'm not going to be responsible. So there was a pin drop silence there. Now that night, because there was event next day also, that night the press club of Chandigarh, they had arranged one dinner. And naturally in Punjab and in the press club, if you have a dinner, there has to be pre-dinner program also. So there was a pre-dinner drinks program. I purposely went late. I thought, let the people, get excited and really charged up. Let them be two drinks down when I reach there. So at about 8 o'clock when I reached there, then I saw that gentleman who was leading that group of people who were with black flags. And he was drinking. And the moment he saw me, he was the first one to greet me. And he came forward. And he, of course, he spoke in Punjabi to me because he was a Sikh. And I'm a Punjabi. So he spoke in Punjabi language to me. And he said, he urgently needs to talk to me in person. No, there should not be anybody around. I said, okay. Then he said, you pick up your drink and let us go to a corner. So we did that. And when I went to the corner, he started pleading with me that, sir, you withdraw that. See, this is the person who was shouting slogans that I will not allow nuclear power station in Punjab. But he started pleading with me that please withdraw the statement. I am cutting short the story. He took out a drawing. It was a map, and it had shown it was the map of that locality and the place where probably the power station was to come. And there were some plots around that. So he said, actually, my business is I'm purchasing the land around this area. So because of the rumor that this area will be taken over by the government and nuclear power station will come, rates have come down. So I'm purchasing all the land and then I will be developing it and then I will be selling the plots. So sir, I'm requesting you hold for one year. In 1 year, my business will be complete. So you just announced today that actually you have now talked to your department and what statement you gave in the afternoon is not true. You may go for a power station. And in lieu of that, he offered me, he said, on this map, wherever you put your finger, one or two plots, I will give you free of cost. So this is the whole game. I'm telling you, this is the whole game. So when we see the public perception, when we see the public opposition, there is a lot of activity, unseen activity, which is behind all that. It is not really the perceived risk of the people. It is a risk, perceived risk imposed on them in the form of this. It's a big exercise. So anyway, to reduce that gap, we need to do the risk communication. So the role of risk communication becomes important so as to reduce the vulnerability by closing the gap between scientifically assessed risk and the risk perceived by the public. So I call it the dampening effect. So we have to dampen that gap. We have to reduce that gap. And as such, see, communication is not something the West has taught us, or it is not something we are learning from the people of other countries. It is taught by our own country. I think all of you will agree that in Chanakya Niti for conflict management, I think very popular, Sam, Dam, Dand, Bhed. So in that, Sam actually means talking to people, communicating with people. Of course, there are other means like compensating people by giving cash or kind, then by punishing them, and then by strategizing the whole thing. But anyway, I'm talking only about communication, which I have done. Other three I have never done. Okay. So we move to next slide. I said, did you not change the slide? The Chanakya slide. Huh? Okay. I am sorry. So as you see the Chanakya Niti, Sam, Dam, Dand, Bhed, I talked about it. Okay. So this slide I have shown only to show that the risk communication, or even if there is no risk, there is some conflict, there is some issue to be managed. I think the first and the foremost step is communication with the people. Next slide, please. Now here I start my actually presentation with the, you know, I will read the bottom part of this slide first. So public perception is, so bottom part I am reading, public perception is against the use of nuclear energy when all the scientific experts have declared how safe actually it is. You know, the assessed risk is really very bare minimum, but the perceived risk is very, very high. Okay. You say the probability of accident is very, very low in nuclear power station, but they say no, so many accidents have happened, so it is very accident. You ask anybody about nuclear power in general public, they will say it is a accident prone industry. Okay, so the problem is the huge difference between scientific facts and an exaggerated public perception of the risks. So this has to be reduced. Now, was it always like this? Was public always afraid of nuclear energy? Let us go back a little into the history. Now, what is the history of atomic energy? I mean, I am not talking only of nuclear power here. What is the history of radiation and radioactivity and atomic energy? It's only 125 years. Okay? Not even 125 years are also, I mean, okay, 125 years are over for X-ray discovery. So in these 125 years of radiation, actually this is my own, based on my own thoughts, this period I divide into three eras of radiation, radioactivity and atomic energy. So first almost 40 years, first one third of this period is, I call it honeymoon period. Reason being, what is honeymoon period? The husband and wife are newly wed. They do not know much about each other. Okay. They only, and whatever they know is only goody-goody. That is why they got married, because they thought good about each other. So they have got married. They don't know the risks ahead in future. Okay. So everything being goody-goody, they are just enjoying their life. Okay. So this period, probably in a married life, it lasts maybe a month, 6 months. If somebody is lucky, 1 or 2 years. Somebody is extremely lucky, 10 years. Somebody is extremely, extremely lucky, maybe the whole time, the whole period goes like a honeymoon period. But I think that is quite rare. I think those who are married will agree with me. So I think depending on individual cases, this honeymoon period, the length of that, it will vary. So here in case of radiation, radioactivity and atomic energy, it lasted about 40-45 years. And this involved early development of radiotherapy and radiography. Now this radiotherapy and radiography, not as they are practiced today, totally unsafe way of doing radiotherapy and radiography. Even radium salts were sometimes applied on the skin. You know, radium salts, they will be directly applied on the skin. So that kind of treatment was being done. And ultimately, then third thing what I have written is radio quackery. Now, what is this radio quackery? In the name of radioactivity, lot of products were being sold. Some of them were not really radioactive, but some of them were really genuinely radioactive. So, to this extent, people were honest. So it started with sale of naturally radioactive water. You know, as you know, there are some water sources, some springs from where naturally a little extra radioactive water comes out. And that water was being bottled and sold. And it was being told to people that it is a treatment for every disease. It will clean the body. And when naturally this, how much naturally radioactive water you will get. So finally they started spiking the ordinary water with some radioactivity. And what radioactivity they will use? They will use the salts of thorium and radium. So thorium and radium salts will be added to the drinking water. Of course, a very small amount. And then that will be told that this is man-made radioactive water. Drink this and enjoy good health. And not only water, then it started with some facial creams, Of course, nowadays you see in India they sell a lot of fair and lovely type of creams for people like me who are dark complexion. So they will say apply this cream and you will become a fair skinned person. So similarly, in those days they were selling radioactive creams which were laced with thorium and radium salts to be applied on your face so that your face will brighten up. And there were chocolates which were radioactive, which were spiked with radioactivity. There were some pads, you know, nowadays we use electric pads for you know, fomenting our body, but at that time there was radioactivity pads which you put on your body so that you get rid of many medical problems. And then, please excuse me, I have a little problem, you know, I am supposed to be on bed rest, so I have to change my stance every now and then. Okay, so this is that period where you could sell anything and people were not afraid of radioactivity. They were taking. Then finally it came down in the early 30s because of one typical, actually two different cases. One was, there was one golf player, popular golf player of America, who was a steel tycoon also. Now he met some accident, so he was not playing for some time. At that time his friend suggested that they have heard about some potion, magic potion called Thorad, which is good for bones and all. So he went and met somebody and he was told, yes, you can take these bottles of Thorad, which is aqueous solution of thorium and radium salts. And you are supposed to drink only two bottles in a day. Take one bottle, half an ounce bottle. This one bottle you drink in the morning, one bottle in the evening. So anyway, he purchased some quantity and he came home and then he prescribed to himself that, because he wanted to become very strong. So instead of two bottles every day, he started taking six bottles every day. So two bottles in the morning, two bottles in the noon, and two bottles in the evening or night. So six bottles every day. I think each bottle contained about half a microcurie of radioactivity. So half into six, so 3 microcurie every day he started taking in form of alpha emitters. So imagine what would have happened to his body. And after 3 years, naturally, slowly his health started deteriorating. And after 3 years, he died. When he died, there was a lot of hangama that how he died and all. So I think the story goes, I don't know, I'm not very sure whether it is true or not. So people say that his postmortem was done and there were found holes in his bones because of the direct alpha irradiation of his bones. But anyway, first time people came to know that all these magic potions, how dangerous they are. And similarly, I think a story which you people know, the radium dials, the watch dials. So those ladies, many of those ladies, they died of oral cancer because they applied that solution of radium chloride or whatever the radioactive dye was there on their teeth also. So because of this, people then came to know that these are very dangerous things. So this radio quackery came to an end, and the honeymoon with atomic energy also came to an end. And somewhere in 1939, with the discovery of fission, nuclear fission, and later chain reaction, and the rest you know, then the World War II and bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and then after that, the Atom for Peace program, establishment of IAEA, and then open air and underground nuclear tests, and slow growth of nuclear power. All this happened in this second period, which I am calling from 1930s to late 1970s. Particularly the 1970s saw a terrible growth in nuclear power in Europe and in USA. And then came the third period, I would say after 1978. So 1979 to till date, I think we are into that third era. And it started with a bang. 1979, there was that Three Mile Island accident, And because of that accident, of course, there was a lot of public perception. And in fact, we are answering questions even till date. And then, of course, not only Three Miles Island, three accidents have happened in this period. So three accidents, international cooperation in regulation and safety, climate change, the talks on climate change, and role of nuclear power in mitigation of climate change. Then intermittent, slow down, then again growth, then slow down. All this has been going on. So I think why I showed this slide is that, you know, the public perception right from the beginning, it is not a constant thing. It has been changing. In fact, it started with the very positive perception about atomic energy. But nowadays, it is not all that positive. People are, in general, most of the people, they are afraid of atomic energy. Now I move to the next slide. I have to, I think, really hurry up. So I think this slide I will allow to go. This is, again, that the public, how these perceptions develop. It is because of some anti-organizational propaganda by NGOs, by media. I'll be talking about that later. Then the public has some expectations from a given project. Then there is a fear of unknown or little known. Then there are unfulfilled promises. Whenever there are expectations, then there will be unfulfilled promises also. So all this contributes to the perceptions in the public, and the public becomes negative about any project. It is not only relevant to atomic energy projects, any project. I think this is what happens if it is not addressed properly. Next slide, please. So the question is, when to communicate? When do we communicate? Should we wait for a crisis to happen? So whenever, I mean, many people suggest that when public is not opposing, why to communicate with them? But I think I do not agree with this. I start discussion on this with this Kabir ka doha, one couplet. Dukh mein sumiran sab karein, sukh mein kare na koi, jo sukh mein sumiran karein, to dukh kahe ko hoy. So this actually says that people in general, they remember God or they pray God only when there is a misery. But when they are happy, they forget God. They think that anyway, there is no need to remember God. And then the poet says that if they were remembering God during happy times, then probably the bad times, the misery time would not have come. So I think we should understand the essence here. So what is the takeaway from this couplet as far as the communication people are concerned? So we should not wait for a crisis to happen. Acceptance and credibility, they should be built in happier times. And acceptance and credibility, these are two very important things when you are involved in risk communication. Because people should believe, they should have trust in you, whatever you are telling. Because you are telling something different from whatever they feel. So there should be a reason for them to trust in you. Okay? And this trust should be built not when they are shouting slogans. This trust should be built in happier times. Next slide, please. Now, to whom to?
Dr. Malhotra.
Yes.
We are about 40 minutes now. You just try to see how much more time you require.
I think at least 10-15 minutes. Kindly allow me.
Huh? Okay.
I'm trying to hurry up. Yeah. So with whom to communicate? I think practically with everybody. Now here, in fact, I have divided this. Basically, this slide is a result of my discussion with a South Korean team. They had come to India. I had a discussion with them. So they had a similar slide. So basically, I have borrowed the idea from them, but built on that. Their original slide was slightly different from this. But basically, the idea is that the public can be divided into four groups. And on x-axis, there is knowledge. So knowledge is plotted. On y-axis is the level of participation, how active the people are and how knowledgeable they are. So these are plotted. So based on this, you have four groups: low, 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 high, 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 and high, low. Okay. So the first group, in the green color, so low knowledge, low activity. See, I think most of the general public will fall into this category. Why should they know about what is nuclear fission? why should they know about how does a nuclear power station work? So normally they will not be bothered, so they don't have the knowledge, and most of the media also will behave like that. Then there is high low, so high knowledge but activity is low. So this is I call it aware publics. So what is it, who are there in this? The opinion leaders. I mean, after a lot of discussions with the Department of Atomic Energy or the government body, they would have acquired knowledge. Then decision makers, academicians, utility professionals, so the people working in NPCIL or DAE, and of course some part of media. See, media I have shown here omnipresent. Media is present everywhere. There are inactive media also, there is aware media also, there is highly active media also, and there is aroused media also. You will have all the four. So media is present everywhere. Then you have these NGOs and social groups in the active publics. They have the knowledge. They will spread the wrong knowledge. Actually, they have the right knowledge, but they will always tell ulta to the society. And then, of course, the last fourth one is no knowledge, but they are aroused. They are excited. So like what happened at the Kudankulam, you know, few years back. So they did not have knowledge about nuclear power, but they were highly against nuclear power, shouting slogans and demonstrating against nuclear power. So I think, but we need to communicate with each of them with the help of these arrows. I have tried to show the orange arrows are showing that how people are, you know, see, especially from green block, they are getting excited and directly going without gaining any knowledge. They are getting excited. That is the most dangerous thing. As I already told you at Kudankulam, this is what had happened. So there is a competition between the active publics and the aware publics. And normally you will find aware publics is busy with their main profession is not communication. Their main profession is setting up a nuclear power station. Okay, they are busy doing that. So they forget about the communication. While the other group, the active publics, the environmental groups, their main profession is opposing nuclear power. So they do that. So generally they score over these the real professionals. So I have tried to explain that if you communicate properly with all these groups, I think the situation can be handled properly. Now, what are you supposed to communicate and how should you communicate? Now, what are these public perceptions actually? What is there in the minds of the people? So this first perception is, why nuclear power at all? Renewables can do the job. Now, I'm not going to discuss this because this is not part of risk communication. And of course, I'm not trying to advertise for Professor Ramamurthy and Professor Dinesh Srivastav. Recently, they have written a book. So those who want to know more about why nuclear power at all, I think they should read that book, though it is a little highly priced, but very knowledgeable book. So buy it and read it. I think you will get many very good answers for this first question. Why nuclear power at all? Renewables can do this job, or I can give a separate lecture on this topic some other time. Then there is second one, is nuclear power safe? After all, so many accidents have already happened. This is a very important issue. I will devote some time to this. Next one is, what about the radiation and the radioactivity continuously leaking out of the nuclear power plant? So an accident doesn't need to happen. Every day radiation is leaking out and people are getting cancer and all. Then, so this also I will discuss. Now the next point, again, I will not be discussing. Is it not too costly? Actually, it is a white elephant. Today I will not be discussing about it. Next one is, why are you going crazy with nuclear power? There are so many countries who are closing down their nuclear power stations. I will devote a minute or two on this. Then what about long-lived, highly radioactive and hazardous nuclear waste? Again, I will devote some time on this. And the next two, I am not going to discuss. The hot water thrown back into the sea reservoir adversely affects the aquatic life and livelihood of the fishermen, etc. I think this has been addressed, but today at least I will not be speaking about it. And finally, nuclear power plant negates right to life guaranteed under Article 21 of the Constitution. Now, to conserve time, I think let me discuss these points briefly. So the question is, now my slides will be in this form, that what is the question raised by the people? Is nuclear power safe? And they know the answers, they know it all. After all, so many accidents have already happened. By the way, my question to them is, how many are required to make so many? Usually I ask them. And they have a prediction also. Their prediction is that it is, the prediction is with respect to Fukushima. So they say if it is, it has already happened in Japan, next one will certainly be here in India. Because this, the reason for this is made in Japan syndrome. You know, I am very proud that I have a Sony TV at home. I am very proud that I have a Toshiba fridge in my house. I am very proud that I have a Hitachi washing machine in my house. So in general, I believe in Japan technology. So I think there is a, so let me go to the next slide to explain this. Now, as far as the safety and the number of accidents is concerned, see, here there is a summary of severe accidents where at least 5 people should have died. See, there is an institute called Paul Scherrer Institute in Switzerland. They are one of the businesses is they are record keepers of accidents. But they define accidents. They say something can be accident only if 5 people die. If even 5 people have not died, it's, let's not call it accident. So, I mean, it is their definition. So, there, this summary means they will record only those events where at least 5 people have died. And they have covered the period 1970 to 2008. And as you can see, I think I will, anyway, the slides are with you people. You can go through later. Only note that in the case of nuclear, there is only one accident they have listed. And only 31 people have died. Now here, let me explain that why only one accident is listed. Because they have listed only Chernobyl, where more than 5 people died. They have not listed Three Miles Island because not a single person had died there. So they have not listed it as an accident. Similarly, of course, Fukushima is outside the report of their period because this report is 1970 to 2008. So it shows data only up to 2008. And that is why you don't see Fukushima here. But even if this report was prepared after 2008 or after 2011, this number would have still been one because again in Fukushima, not a single person has died because of the nuclear power and nuclear accident. Okay, and another thing which I wanted to tell you here is that in case of coal, for example, total recorded accidents are 2,526 in that period, and out of which 2,032 are in China. So it speaks a lot about safety in coal mining in China. And fatalities also, if you see, close to almost 42,000 fatalities, out of which 27,000 are from China itself. Similarly, again, in case of hydro, though there have been 23 accidents, fatalities are 30,200 and about 30,000 are from China itself in one accident. In 1976, one dam burst took place and that 30,000 people died within 3 hours. I'm not trying to paint that hydro is dangerous. I'm only telling you more accidents have happened in other sectors and more people have died in other sectors, energy producing sectors. So, I mean, to blame only nuclear or to be afraid of only nuclear, to think that there is high risk in nuclear is not correct. Then, of course, I think I will forego this slide. It only compares the seismic hazards in Japan and India and the tsunami hazards in Japan and India. They are to orders of magnitude higher in Japan. I think you people already know, slides are there with you. But when somebody has to communicate with the public, they have to tell them that look, what happened in Japan, the chances of that happening in India are very, very low. The reason being that most of the nuclear power stations in India, except the one in Narora, all others are in seismic zone 2 or 3. Okay, while in case of Japan, all of them are in zone 4 or above. Okay, and similarly, the tsunami, if you see, that there is a fault parallel to the map of Japan. So anywhere this tsunami can come, all along Japan. And all, incidentally, all nuclear power stations, most of them are on this side of Japan, where the fault is there. And in India, there are only three faults much away from India. One is near Karachi, 900 kilometers away from Tarapur. And another is 1,600 kilometers away. I mean, at the Kanyakumari is 1,600 kilometers away from Chagos Ridge. And then this Sundra Arc near Indonesia, from there also 1,300 kilometers away. Now, I'll quickly go to next slide. I think this, in the discussion, I can talk about it. I think I have no time to discuss this slide. But this one I can show. What are the facts? The fact is, this AERB publishes every year. See, last time, Dr. Parthasarathy was there. They have done a lot of work. They report this every year, that against the background, this red tower, the red color tower is the background radiation, 2,400 microsievert per year. And then 1,000, the gray tower, is allowed above that 2,400. But the actual emission, as you can see, is a very, very small fraction. Okay. And the facts are that, in fact, no cancer occurrence has been found. Increased cancer occurrence has been found around nuclear power stations, whether in India or anywhere in the world. And of course, when you talk about genetic disorders, even Dr. Parthasarathy had told that even amongst the survivors of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, there has been no report of genetic defects in their subsequent generation. So this is actually totally wrong. What is told, that near power stations or near uranium mines, you will find genetically defected children, newborns. This is wrong. And this is radiation effect of life, that radiation is there everywhere and contribution from nuclear is actually negligible. This is what is shown. This is an IAEA slide. Sorry, I think I will not dwell too much on this. And actually, you know, the acquisition of nuclear, that a lot of accidents have happened and a lot of people have died. It is the reverse, actually. It has saved a lot of lives. As per WHO, so far, about 1.9 billion lives have been saved by nuclear power. Because if nuclear power was not there, all that electricity would have been produced by burning coal, and there would have been even more pollution. And as per WHO, 1.9 billion more people would have died, as they have died. About 7 billion people die every year because of pollution. Okay, so I think the message in this slide is only to tell the public that, look, you feel nuclear power is killing. Actually, nuclear power is saving lives. This needs to be communicated. And of course, on one side, people will be afraid of nuclear power station or a uranium mine, but they will willingly, they will go to a place like Guarapari in Brazil, where there is radioactive sand. They will bury themselves in this radioactive sand, and they will even sometimes measure the radiation, as you see in this picture. And this is a health resort, actually. You know, it is known as that beach is known as Praia da Preta, means beach of the black sand. The sand is black because of presence of high quantity of thorium. And then this particular place, the city is known as Cidade de Saúde, the city of health. The Guarapari is known by that name. And people stay in hotels. Names of hotels are thorium, radium, names of this type, radioactive isotopes. And people take sun bath thinking that all their diseases will be taken away by radiation. And in fact, people believe that, as you can see, this gentleman around 60 years of age, he thinks he will become like a 20-year-old if he takes sufficiently good dose of radiation. But the same guy you tell that we want to build a nuclear power station next to your locality, he will be the first one with black flags shouting against nuclear power. Now, another question is, what about long-lived, highly radioactive and hazardous nuclear waste? So what about the nuclear waste? So this is a problem without any solution. Public has declared this is a problem without any solution. Generations, the future generations will pay dearly for our ruthless decisions. What is the fact? Now, those who know about nuclear power. So, I mean, we have to tell public that amount of fuel used for generating same amount of electricity is much, much smaller in the case of nuclear power as compared to, let us say, coal generated power. Okay. Then out of that fuel, only about 0.1% becomes waste. Okay. Not more than 0.1%. That is the high level waste which we are talking about. So the volume of the waste is very low, and there is a technology available, and it is still evolving. So here, normally I give examples. You know, I confront the people, though I am running really short of time, but I think one of them I will tell you. I have listed here some stories: lion versus mosquito, potassium cyanide versus common salt. Let me give only one story: potassium cyanide versus common salt. Now we know which one is poison out. Potassium cyanide is poison, and common salt is something edible. It is part of our integral part of our diet. But whenever we visit our doctors, particularly when we are older than 40 years, when we go to the doctor, in my life, any doctor has never advised me not to take potassium cyanide. But every doctor on every visit, even if I have got a small fracture, the doctor tells me, reduce your salt intake, reduce your sugar intake, reduce pickles, reduce papadam, reduce bhajia, reduce samosa. But none of them tells me reduce potassium cyanide. Why is it so? Because he knows. He knows very well, I don't consume potassium cyanide. It is not available with me. And if I had consumed, I will not be there talking to that doctor. So there is actually no fear from potassium cyanide. So though potassium cyanide is potentially more dangerous than common salt, but the real danger today to our life is coming from common salt because we are exposed to it. So similarly, high level radioactive waste you compare with carbon dioxide. High level radioactive waste is very, very dangerous. It is highly radioactive. But the thing is, it is cut off from the public domain. We have total technology to cut it off from the public domain. But in case of carbon dioxide, actually, which is today, whatever you ate in the breakfast, it is all thanks to carbon dioxide. Okay, whatever you will eat in lunch will be thanks to carbon dioxide. So it is integral part of our life. We are alive because there is carbon dioxide in that one. But the problem is, nature had enough carbon dioxide of its own. It didn't want us to produce carbon dioxide. But what have we done? Whatever carbon or coal nature had prepared in millions of years, we have burnt it off in 200, 300 years. Last 200, 300 years. With the result, carbon dioxide percentage. So I always tell people, in fact, I shout in my lectures. I say that I am declaring, if there will be extinction of life on planet Earth, it will be because of carbon dioxide. Take it from me, it will not be because of radioactive waste or because of radiation. Now, next slide, please. So why are you going crazy with nuclear power? I think I have come almost to an end. Just allow me 5 minutes. So why are you going crazy with nuclear power? So patriotic advice people give is wise countries like Germany are giving it up. So why don't you at DAE also become wise and close down all nuclear power stations? So I think I'll go to the next slide. Germany, I think I will hear only, I will only tell you that Germany right from the beginning, they have not suddenly decided. They have been like this. They have closed many of their operating nuclear power stations in 90s. I mean, much before Fukushima happened. Then in 2000, they had already declared that they will close down their nuclear power stations by 2022. But in 2010, they took a decision that no, they will not close down all their nuclear power stations in 2022. They will do it in maybe mid-2030s. But then Fukushima happened. Again, they told, no, we will close down in 2022. And in fact, why I am talking in risk communication? What is the risk by this? If they want, let them close down. No, but the whole world is at risk. And that is why. Because whatever, they are burning coal. They have reopened some of their brown coal mines. And because of that, there is fresh emission of carbon dioxide, and in fact there is an allegation on them that the nuclear phase out has already caused $12 billion in social costs per year, primarily due to increase in the mortality due to exposure to pollution from fossil fuels, because they have been burning more fossil fuels. Okay, so they have been criticized recently in 2019. About 100 environmentalists and scientists from Poland, they requested Germany to reconsider their decision on the final decommissioning of fully functional nuclear power plants for the benefit of the fight against global warming. So there are things like that. And I think Germany, by the way, appears to be the only wise country in the world. All others seem to be fools. Because if you look at the world map in black color, there is only one map with that shows the phasing out of nuclear power by a country. That Germany is the only country which is phasing out nuclear power by 2022. So I think it is public to judge who is foolish and who is wise. Now, I think a quick comment on media. Media, I think all you know. I don't know whether some friends from media are present in this today's audience. But anyway, no problem. I am telling the truth. See, today's world is exclusive story and breaking news. Every channel will be showing the same story, but they will claim it is breaking news and it is exclusive of their channel. So because of this, sensationalization is an in thing, and confirming verification of the story or of the data, it seems a time wasting exercise. So just giving you an example, Professor Sai Baba is sitting. He is a witness to what is shown in this slide. 2004 tsunami in Bay of Bengal. I think Professor Sai Baba can be the best person to describe what people there had gone through. Many of our colleagues, family members were lost because they drowned. Nothing happened to our technical area, our workplace, but in the colony, water gushed and people, personal, particularly who were living in ground floors, they had to pay some heavy price. But anyway, at that time, somebody reached our site and there he saw one signboard saying prototype fast breeder reactor, you know, and on every site one board will be put. But he saw no building there, and he saw only a pit full of water. So he announced from there that the PFBR building has fallen down. You only see the signboard. Actually, the fact was it was only a pit. There was no building there because it was the excavation pit for PFBR, which is now ready. Anytime it will become on. And similarly, I think Dr. Parthasarathy also mentioned about this particular incident. So on 7th September 2014, Times of India Sunday issue, all the editions in India, they reported cancer behind 70% deaths in India's atomic energy hubs. I was shaken. What is this? And then naturally we started talking to them. They made a fish market out of it. When we started discussing a lot with them, I think other day Dr. Parthasarathy told that Tata Memorial Hospital then gave a statement, which is wrong. Actually, they never gave a statement. The same journalists, they went to Tata Memorial Hospital, discussed with them, again took some data from them, and from there they calculated, and within 3 days, from 70, it became 16, so one-tenth. So now they say 16% deaths at atomic energy centers due to cancer. So this first news had appeared on the front page, top portion. The second news, 16%, was on page 4. And ultimately, because of my, in fact, I fought a lot with them, complained to Press Council of India also. And after about 45 days of fight, finally on page 24, and in one line they wrote, referring to this news of 70% deaths, that there was some mistake in that. So they just issued a corrigendum, which was, you know, in font size 8 and only 2 liners. And of course, see, to boost up the minds of people, see, we don't, not only we have to, through some mathematical data, we have to prove that risk is low. We have to win confidence of people, trust of people. For that, in fact, NPCIL has published these coffee table books which talk about the birds, the butterflies, and the flowers and the flora in general around our nuclear power stations. Fantastic books, everything good about them. Only problem is like the book of Dr. Srivastav's book, no? I was talking high cost. So these books are very costly. So if 100 people visit NPCIL, they can't afford to hand over these three books to them. Each book will cost to them about 1,000 rupees. So very costly books. I mean, not by buying, even to publish them is very costly. So I found a cheaper mode. You know, after all, I'm not from a PSU. I'm from poor government department. So I found a cheaper option. I went through these books. In fact, the first one only, that Flying Guests. I went through the book and converted that into cheap posters. These are A3 size posters I used to distribute to students. And they should give the same information. So pictures of all the birds found around nuclear power stations. And there I pose a question to the children. Can a nuclear power plant be a bird sanctuary? The answer is a resounding yes. So with that confidence, I used to tell people, don't be afraid of a nuclear power station. You want to see birds of various colors, come to a nuclear power station. You will get them to see. I have come to the last slide, and to conclude, let me quote a paragraph from the Supreme Court judgment, which was delivered on May 6, 2013, in the multiple cases filed by many people for closing down Kudankulam nuclear power plant. So the judges write, the petitioner's contention that the establishment of nuclear power plant at Kudankulam will make an inroad into the right to life guaranteed under Article 21 of Constitution, therefore, has no basis. On the other hand, it will only protect the right to life guaranteed under Article 21 of the Constitution for achieving a larger public interest. So this was highly motivating for our department, and we felt that we have been able to communicate at least with the judges very properly. So they could understand what we are saying. So they gave this judgment. I feel every citizen of India becomes like these judges, whom we are able to communicate, and we are able to convince that nuclear power is the need of the hour, and it is a perfectly safe option for generation of electricity. I think whatever responsibility was given to me by Sai Baba, I have done some partial justice to it. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Malhotra. I could not stop you because of your keenness to convey this. Yes, I think you said nicely, the role of risk communication is to reduce the gap between the scientific facts and what people perceive. And that's a big challenge. And you nicely covered about amplification of risk and dampening of risk, you know, dampening effects. I think you covered some of these interesting aspects of it, and also shared the experience of about nuclear. I think you went on to consider nuclear. Now, may I ask the Nandagopan? I think we, as I told you, that these people have identified some questions. I think they'll ask you, and then we can Nandagopan.
So, okay. Thank you for that wonderful presentation, sir. You got really down and dirty with the details of nuclear risk communication over the years. We have a few questions for you. So, for my first question would be, how do you establish, you talked about anti-organizational propaganda by the media and the NGOs. So, but how do you effectively establish trust and communicated message without being accused of spreading government propaganda, organizational kind of propaganda? So when it comes from the department, we may be accused of that. So how do you tackle that?
Yeah, this happens. In fact, very relevant question. In fact, my blunt answer to that will be, take the bull by the horn. I mean, here we are not supposed to become sheepish. At least my policy was that, okay, you want to talk it down with me? Okay. So I used to very boldly, I used to say, this has happened, you know. I will tell you an incident at Pedagattu in Hyderabad, near Nagarjun Sagar Dam. We had a rich uranium deposit there, so there was a public hearing. So we went there, and there were a lot of these environmentalist groups who had come down from Delhi, from Gujarat, somebody had come from Kerala, and somebody had traveled from Tamil Nadu. So like various parts of India, these NGOs had come. And I came to know that we were staying in some, you know, those were the days we were not getting a lot of money from government, you know. Sixth pay commission had not yet come. Sixth pay commission made government officials somewhat, you know, respectable. But before that, we will always look for 30 rupees per day room in some hostel or in some guest house, government guest house, because we won't be able to afford hotels anymore. These guys were staying in 4-star and 5-star hotels, and we were staying in some guest houses of AM. And there I go, and same accusation is put on me. No, don't listen to this fellow. He is paid by Department of Atomic Energy. So, in fact, they use the word stooge. He is a stooge of Department of Atomic Energy. He will speak only what he is told to speak. So, what we are telling is correct. So, I answered your question by saying, take the bull by the horn. So, I immediately got up and I told, it is true that I am paid by Department of Atomic Energy. And why I am paid? I am not a fellow living on roadside. There was an advertisement, thousands of aspirants applied for this post. I was one of the 200 people who were selected at that time in that batch. So I am supposed to be one of those 200 very able fellows. So I was selected by a process, and then yes, I am paid by the government, and it has taught me. It has not ordered me to say all this. I have been trained, and I am 100% convinced about what I am saying. It is it's your business whether you want to believe on or not on me. But now I am putting a cross question to this guy who has accused me. I am asking, this gentleman has come from Gujarat. Now I am telling you, I was given an air ticket by Department of Atomic Energy to come here. Ask him, how has he come? He also has come by flight, let me tell you. Now I want to ask you, who has paid him? And who has told him to talk all this nonsense about atomic energy? If I am talking as told by Department of Atomic Energy, he probably is talking as told to him by his bosses. So, I mean, you have to take the bull by the horns. I think there is no other. Scientifically, yes, you argue anything. You tell me how many people have died. In internet, you will have news that in Chernobyl, close to 900,000 people have died. But the facts are in scientific journals. So you go to the scientific journals and talk on that. Don't talk on internet-based news, which says 916,000 people have died. So I think I think the answer is, you have to speak with conviction, and the general public will make out. You know, they will know the difference between who is talking nonsense or who is telling lies and who is talking with conviction.
Thank you, sir, very much for the discussion. My question is extension of what Nanda asked. How do you effectively communicate about nuclear energy without elevating the common concerns? For example, mining activities that was done in Nalamala forest in Telangana in 2019, I guess. So there were some protests against it. Although DA withdrew from it, but there were still protests against those, and some Facebook posts related to how it could destroy the forest and so on. So my question was, how do you tackle this? You cannot take the entire public by the horns.
Siddharth, I'll tell you one thing.
Yes, sir.
So in this 2019 things, I was not involved, but based on my experience, I can tell you. Now we have not withdrawn from there because public was protesting. You know, we are not bothered about that. We have to withdraw because of the government office. If government tells us to withdraw, which is for their political reasons, you know, they are, see, we don't have to go every 5 years and take votes from people. So we do, see, we will tell based on scientific facts that here mining needs to be done. Now you give us the permission, we will do the mining. The day you withdraw the permission, we will stop the mining. So, I mean, that decision is not because, I mean, we are very clear. We don't take it as a defeat that because people protested, so we have stopped the activity. We have stopped the activity because government asked us to do it. Or it will be based on some scientific facts. You know, certain projects you close down because then you realize that they are not very economical. But yes, some projects suffered. I mean, for example, we have very rich deposit of uranium locked up in Meghalaya. And I feel very sorry. Actually, some of the prime years of my career I have spent in going to Meghalaya, and we had almost succeeded. People had challenged me that I will not be able to conduct a public hearing in that place. And I did it. I should not say I did it. We did it. We, the team of DAE, we did that public hearing. And we succeeded in a good report also. But later on, because of the political will of the state government and all, we have not been able to do mining there. So many times people feel that, if I can use the Hindi word, dar gaya. So it is not dar gaya. It is because of the government restrictions. If government is not allowing us to do the mining, what to do? What we can do? Same is the case of this Ratnagiri project. Lot of people, when I meet people, they feel that the public demonstration was so much against that Ratnagiri project, Jaitapur project, that we had to give in. But the reason I know, the reason is that we have not been able to close our techno-commercial discussions with the French people. We have not yet arrived at a techno-commercial understanding with each other. But people think that it is because of the public perceptions. So yes, but your basic question was that how do you effectively communicate about nuclear energy? Look, we can do only one thing, that we have to tell the truth. We have to tell the scientific truth. And we have to, I think, the way I told Nanda Gopan, that we have to speak the truth and speak with conviction. Rest is up to the public. And then in the process, many a times we have to expose these people. You know, the people who are into agitation against nuclear power, sometimes we have to do the dirty game of not planting anything against them, but expose them. I'll give you one example that at Kudankulam, various modes of agitation were taken. So I think during the agitation, one time they decided that there will be hunger strike. Okay, normally by definition, if you go hunger strike, means those who are sitting on hunger strike, they will not eat anything. Okay, but I think last year you people must have seen, I think now I'm a retired person, I can slightly talk politics. So last year, I think there was a news that this Congress party, somewhere they said they will do hunger strike. And the camera people reached there. So there was one place where they were supposed to sit on the hunger strike. When the camera team reached there, there was nobody there. But they could hear some voices from behind that place. So when they went behind the stage where they were supposed to sit on the hunger strike, they saw all the people who were supposed to sit on the hunger strike, they were eating chole bhature. Okay? So after eating chole bhature, they will come and sit on the hunger strike. And evening, they will call off the hunger strike and probably they will eat some idli and dosa. Okay? Since they have had. So similarly, at Kudankulam, my friend Pallav Bagla, I think all of you know Pallav Bagla, he has worked in Nias. So Pallav Bagla, my friend, I knew that he is camping at Kodankulam. So one day I got the news. I was here in Bombay. I got the news that, sir, those people who are on hunger strike, they are right now eating behind that, you know, they had put up a tent kind of a thing. So behind that, a feast is going on at morning at about 8:30. So I immediately called up Pallav Bagla and I told him, Pallav, you want to see something wonderful? You please go and go to that place and see they are eating. And outside there is a, one indication that there is a hunger strike going on. So Pallav Bagla immediately rushed to that place. And in fact, he was live on television. He was showing, look, friends, here they are supposed to be on hunger strike. But look how they are doing their hunger strike. And then he showed them eating. So I think at times we have to actually catch them, that what they are saying is not true. But at the same time, we have to be very careful. Whatever information we are giving should be scientific truth. We should never be caught on that. So I think as long as that you are doing, automatically the conviction and the confidence comes.
I had another question, sir, regarding vested interest. I think you partially answered that question while you were answering the previous two questions. But I do like to know how you directly handle, you gave one example of one of the locals who was dealing with the property there and how you handled him. So what other kind of vested interests have you come across?
There are vested interests. I will tell another interesting story. Of course, I have a lot of such stories, One very interesting story. There is one name called, I don't know whether you recognize that name. There is a name, Ghanshyam Biruli. This Ghanshyam Biruli is from Jharkhand. And he is son of an ex-employee of UCIL. His father was working in UCIL, worked throughout his life. At the age of 60, he retired and settled very well just outside UCIL. And this son, anyway, I think he did not study and all. So I'm talking somewhere in late 80s, he made an association of people, I think Jharkhand Organization of Unemployed Youth. That was the name of that organization. And he used to come and do some bargains with UCIL. I will organize protests if you don't give job to some of our youths. So sometimes the UCIL will come into that pressure, UCIL has to take only local people, or that the miners we don't bring from another state. You bring mining engineers, physicists and chemists from other places, but to the extent possible, miners are taken from locality only. So, they thought that, okay, we will take from him. So, they said, okay, you give your list. So, I think UCIL, they entertained him once or twice. But then later on, it came to the light that it seems he was charging 25,000 rupees from each candidate. Who will get the job. So this, when it came to be known, if I was there in the picture, I will catch him red-handed so that he will not be able to show his face. But what these UCIL told, no, we will go as per our list, that R&R people, rehabilitation and relocation team, would have got some land record list. So who were the people who were displaced? So we are supposed to give jobs to those people. So they said, no, we will go by our list. And so there was a lot of heated discussion between this fellow, Ghanshyam Biruli. And so somewhere in 1991, now he saw that his Jharkhand Organization of Unemployed Youth is not working. So overnight, he made another organization, which has now become very famous, actually. Even internationally, it is famous. It is Jharkhand Organization Against Radiation, JOAR, J-O-A-R. You just type J-O-A-R on Google and you will find his name and lot of reports. Okay, so Jharkhand Organization Against Radiation. But he is president of both the organizations. So as far as the first organization is concerned, he has to come to the table of UCIL for bargaining. And as far as the second one is concerned, he has to shout slogans against the UCIL. So once actually we had a meeting in Meghalaya, and you know, I used to keep a tab on him. So on a Friday, he attended a meeting at UCIL and he signed on a paper that Jharkhand organization against of this unemployed youth agrees with UCIL and following people will be given jobs. And there he has signed. Okay. And then he has come to Meghalaya. I obtained that paper from UCIL headquarters. I got a fax. Okay. Then at Meghalaya, he is telling, don't allow uranium mine to come up in Meghalaya. People will die because the miners at Jharkhand are dying every day. They are getting cancer. Their family are getting cancer. So like that, he made accusations. So for giving the reply, always being the spokesperson of DAE, it is my duty to reply. So immediately I was given the chance. So I came there and that whatever facts I had, you know, I had made a transparency out of it that I displayed publicly. I said today is Monday and he's talking about miners dying in mine. And on Friday he has signed this document. These 75 people will be given jobs of miners in Jharkhand mine. So that means he is pushing them for dying by cancer. Now ask him, why is he allowing those 75 people to die of cancer? So like that, you know, these people who have the vested interest, you have to catch hold of that vested interest. I'll give you another example, which is probably not directly connected to Department of Atomic Energy. Once I was invited to attend a meeting in Delhi and this Sunita Narayan was there. They were releasing a report on waste, you know, waste disposal, this highly radioactive waste disposal. She had made a report and they were releasing that report. So, and they had a discussion also. So they had invited chairman nominated that Malhotra, you go. So I was present there. Then anyway, see, whatever discussion on nuclear waste they did, I gave a fitting technical reply to that. But in addition to that, I said, madam, it was my lifetime ambition to meet you someday. I was addressing Sunita Narayan. I said, it was my lifetime ambition to meet you one day and ask one single question to you. So she said, yes, you please ask. I said, this question has nothing to do, but as I'm not sure I will ever meet you in my life, so I'm using the opportunity. Please answer my question. I have read your reports, you know, a lot of reports where you have analyzed Coca-Cola, Pepsi and other such drinks. And you have told about some residuals in that. You are talking about residuals of some medicines which are used in agriculture, pesticides. So pesticide residues found in Coca-Cola and Pepsi and other popular brands. So I said, madam, my understanding is that the bulk of this Pepsi and cola or any such cold drinks, the bulk material is water. And so this water, they may not be importing from Europe. They must be taking from the local resource. And they may be purifying that water to some extent. But this pesticide residue, which is coming in the cold drink, have you any time analyzed that? Is it there in water or not? No, they are making huge profit. They are not supposed to sell. Even if in the water it is there, they are not supposed to do. I said, madam, see, you are concerned about the safety of the people. Now tell me, more number of people are drinking that water from where these cold drinks are being made, or more number of people are taking these cold drinks? Naturally, the answer is more number of people are consuming more quantities of water from where the cold drink is made. very less number of people are drinking cold drink, and even the amount taken is less. So the question is, now please you tell me a data, how many municipalities you have questioned about the presence of this residue of pesticides in their municipality waters? She had not done. I said, do you know the reason for this? Because when you raise your voice against Pepsi and Cola, there is somebody to make huge payments. But if you make such allegations against municipalities, municipalities are the fellows who collect money. They don't distribute money. They are known for collecting money, not for distributing. So you will not get anything from there. She got really, I mean, she shouted at the top of her voice, how come you allege me like that? I said, you give me another scientific reason that why you are after Pepsi and Cola and not after the municipalities. You give me a satisfying scientific answer, I will withdraw my allegation. But she had nothing. So I think what you are telling, that how to expose these vested interests, this is how we have to catch them. In the beginning, I said, I mean, don't be sheepish. This is what I have learned. I think you can't be a gentleman with these guys. You have to catch the bull by the horn. I'm repeating, I think, probably fourth time.
Yeah, good.
Sir, my question is, according to you, what are the main public concerns related to nuclear technology in India? Like you have cited already a few, like mining is there, then there is vested interest.
I listed some of them. I think one slide shows all of them, I think. And I discussed some majority of them, I discussed also. So major concerns, see, major concern they will show is, see, actually, some are genuine fears. Mm-hmm. Then there are other than fears. So, see, when you, I think I must answer in the form of a narrative only. So I think Sai Baba will be furious. But I'll give you another example. I went to, NFC is building their second complex at Rajasthan. Nuclear fuel complex, which is presently at Hyderabad and in Tamil Nadu. They are now building a huge complex in Rajasthan. So I think somewhere in 2013, there was a public hearing for that. And another Sai Baba, who was chief executive of nuclear complex at that time, he is N. Sai Baba, another good friend. I think I am destined to have all Sai Babas are my good friends. Okay, so he insisted that he will conduct the public hearing only if I am attending. So anyway, I went there and attended. And believe me, see, now Rajasthan, we have a huge complex. The 6 reactors already operating there, 7th and 8th under construction. And heavy water board is there. So lot of, I mean, nuclear activities are there. And now we are trying to put up NFC. So when I went there in public hearing, actually, what is the definition of public hearing? That any fear if people are having, if they feel that establishment of this industry at this place will cause some harm to their lives, to their profession, to their health, or in any way it will disturb them, they are supposed to bring out only that. Okay, nothing else is supposed to be discussed. But then these are the people, local people, they will talk anything and they don't ask any questions. They will come and give speeches. So we were sitting there. That public hearing is the longest public hearing I have attended in my life. It started at 10:30 and ended at 6 o'clock in the evening. We missed our lunch. So I saw that about 33 people, they came and delivered their speeches. Now, none of them talked about any fear or environmental issue due to establishment of NFC there. They were only talking against NPCIL. They were telling NPCIL had promised this. They have not given this. NPCIL does not give admission to sufficient number of people from our locality in their schools. So all the issues were, I mean, none of them was concerning the public fears about our activity. It was only, as I told, showed you in one slide, expectations not being met. So broken promises. So they talked only about broken promises. I think if we can fully satisfy them by giving whatever they want, which is not always possible, I think they will have no fears. So otherwise, the scientific fears I have listed. Otherwise, there is no dearth. They will ascribe everything bad which is happening to only atomic energy. I can tell you a case of USA, where one gentleman who had worked during construction of a nuclear power station. So only during construction, for 2 years he worked. He was a civil engineer. Then he went away from there, got married, and after 3 years, had a son. Now, unfortunately, that son had a brown patch on his back. Okay, he sued that power station, which was still not operational. He sued that power station that because for 2 years I worked in a nuclear power in the construction of a nuclear power station, because of some genetic effect, my son is having brown patch on his back. In US, all sorts of nonsensical cases you can find. And that case was fought. And then, of course, I think it was a laughable stuff that you worked during the construction of a nuclear power. So there was no radiation, no radioactivity. How can you talk of effect of nuclear power on the son who is born after 4 years of that? So I think that this list will be endless. A genuine list I have already presented. You can see that slide.
Yeah.
But this list is unending.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Malhotra. I know that we can have almost day-long discussion with you. Let me thank you again for sharing your experience and the excitement of sharing that, what work you have done. And I'm sure that you also dwelt on the risk communication itself and then dealt a lot about nuclear. I think, always somehow risk and nuclear has become very synonymous. But there are a lot of issues which have to be discussed about. I think one of the main reasons why we have problems in the risk communication is the disparities which are there in the society. And that is the reason why people think that this is a way of getting something out of this. So thank you. And I know that we really exceeded the time. Otherwise, I would have allowed some more discussion. But I think we'll stop here. I thank you again for agreeing to be part of this series. And I'm sure that the students many of the people who attended are students of risk communication and science communication. I'm sure that they've benefited listening to you. A big thanks to you and thanks to all the participants.